Hey, Will Sherland with Gutter Fighting Secrets. Today, what I'm going to be talking about is what is the difference between Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and Japanese Jiu-Jitsu? This is a question that I hear asked kind of a lot in the Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu circle. And truth be told, I only really knew the basics about it myself, so I decided to do some research. And in this research, I decided, hey, you know what? I might as well make a YouTube video about it because I'm sure there's other people out there kind of wondering the same thing. So, let's dive into it. I'm going to start with Japanese Jiu-Jitsu and give you kind of a brief history on that. Alright, so Japanese Jiu-Jitsu started out in the old days of feudal Japan. And what it was an unarmed system of fighting for the samurai. Now, the samurai, it's pretty interesting. You can draw a lot of comparisons to the samurai of old and today's modern military. Because contrary to popular belief, the samurai like to start out from a very far range away, and use bow and arrows, incendiaries, you know, launching fire and stuff at each other. Then maybe they'd get close enough to use spears. Then they'd close that distance, use their swords. And if they needed to, maybe something happened to their sword or whatever, they'd have knives and, you know, bare hands as well. And they had systems of training for each and every one of these disciplines of warfare. You know, they would train with the spears in a certain way. They would obviously train with the bows and arrows and the horseback. They would train, with the swords, and they would also have separate disciplines or training holes for the hand-to-hand combat. And that hand-to-hand combat was known as jiu-jitsu, or at least today is known as jiu-jitsu. Now, like I said, I just thought that was interesting because, you know, in today's military, obviously, you know, you'd have the guys shooting the artillery at each other, this and that. You know, you train with the grenade launchers and stuff. Then, you know, you learn how to shoot a rifle. Obviously, if your rifle goes down, you can transition to your pistol. If your pistol goes dry for whatever reason, obviously, you usually have a knife. You can transition to that. And should worst come to worst, you can transition over to empty hands. So it's like Mad Dog Mattis said, you know, there's nothing new under the sun when it comes to warfare. But I don't know, maybe we've come full circle as far as warfare goes anyways. But that leads me into another point, is that jiu-jitsu was primarily composed of chokes, joint locks, throws. Reason being is these guys were fighting each other in big, heavy, clunky armor. So, number one, it's clunky, you can't move well. Joint locks, obviously, throwing them down and choking him, stuff like that, works a lot better than trying to punch each other. But number two is their armor is thick and obviously meant to, you know, withstand sword cuts and arrows and shit. So, you don't want to necessarily try to hit a guy with armor. It's not going to be great for your hands and it's not going to do him that much damage. So that was kind of the original jiu-jitsu. It was all made for a specific cause, a specific reason for specific military personnel that were dressed in heavy armor and needed a system of unarmed fighting or fighting, you know, defending against a knife or whatever that suited their specific needs for a specific style of training. Which again goes kind of today because our guys are dressed in all this armor now and what are we doing? We're doing jiu-jitsu. It's maybe somebody thought of that, but hey, maybe they didn't. Maybe, like I said, we've just come full circle as far as the society goes. But that was Japanese jiu-jitsu. And it wasn't pretty. It definitely wasn't meant for sport. It was meant for killing your opponent. Another trained warrior wearing armor. So, time progressed, and eventually the samurai got outlawed in Japan. You might be familiar with that movie, Last Samurai, with what's his name? Say what you will about that movie. It is kind of cool to watch it and see this point in Japanese history where the samurai were like outlawed and Japan went into being more of a civil, quote-unquote gentlemanly type place. So obviously, jiu-jitsu and sword fighting no longer really had any relevancy in Japanese culture or society. And also due to the fact that jiu-jitsu, along with a lot of the other arts of the samurai, were meant to be handed down from generation to generation of samurai, and not ever really meant for the general public or the serfdom class or whatever. So I guess you could say authentic pure water jiu-jitsu kind of fell by the wayside. However, there were guys who learned jiu-jitsu and, you know, came from that samurai warrior lineage of feudal Japan. And these guys didn't want this stuff, these arts, to go completely and vanish into history. So they started taking them and adapting them for more of a sports competition-based environment. Now, one of these guys was a guy by the name of Jigoro Kainu, and he basically took jiu-jitsu and started stripping away all of the really hardcore stuff that would get his students injured. He actually kept statistics on it and figured out, okay, well, when my students get injured, they're doing this technique or this technique. And he kind of stripped that all away from it and tried to make it as safe for a sport as possible. And eventually this became known as judo. Now, this guy Kano, as anybody else would, really wanted to show off and advertise his new system of fighting. So he would send his students out kind of all over the world to demonstrate judo and also to challenge other fighting systems and ultimately prove judo to be the most efficient fighting art in the world. I don't know, maybe that sounds familiar to you. He had two conditions though. Number one, you couldn't use judo and fight for money. And number two, you couldn't teach judo to anybody who was a foreigner or non-Japanese. You could show them some techniques, but you couldn't teach the full system from, you know, white to black belt or whatever. The Japanese have always historically had a fear of foreigners, and they still do to some degree, maybe rightfully so, but this was definitely a fear of Kano's. He didn't want his judo to fall into the wrong hands. Now, one of his students was a guy by the name of Mitsuyo Aida, and he would travel around the world, you know, demonstrating judo. He ultimately, from what I understand, found himself in America. But unfortunately for Maeda, the Americans loved to fight, but they weren't much for all of this bowing and the whole rituals of, you know, Japanese martial arts and the discipline. I mean, we Americans, we just like to fight. That's just who we are. So ultimately, he kind of found himself, you know, going on hard times. I mean, he couldn't fight for money. That was the rules. You know, he couldn't teach this system really from white to black belt. So what was he going to do? Now, ultimately, he met a Japanese businessman. I believe he was living in New York at the time. And this Japanese businessman basically made him a proposition. Hey, I'll give you $1,000 if you can win like a no-holds-barred underground kind of fight. Now, this Maeda guy was a really tough SOB. So, you know, he said, look, screw it. Why not? But before he went ahead and did that, he did two things. Number one, he changed his name from Mitsuyo Aida to Count Koma. And the second thing that he did was to change the name of his fighting art from judo back to jujitsu, thus probably giving him an out so that he wouldn't be using the judo, you know, name and disgracing it, you know, thus bringing shame on himself or whatever. So Maeda basically went on to become a pretty serious prize fighter. He would fight, he would make a lot of money, he would spend that money, then he would fight again, get more money, spend it, you know, and the cycle continued. Now, Maeda would win these fights against stronger, bigger Western opponents by using a lot of the techniques that he learned that came from jiu-jitsu that were taken out to create judo, and he would use these techniques to great efficiency. So like I said, you know, he would win a fight or a couple fights, and then guys would be like, no, I'm not going to fight this guy. It's just too dangerous. We don't want to risk it. Or he's too good. You know, we can't win against him. So he'd have to pick up and move to another country or another place. And eventually he found himself in Brazil, where he met a promoter by the name of Gastão Gracie. And Mr. Gracie promised, you know, that he could get him some good fights and make him a lot of money, which he did. But ultimately the cycle continued and Maeda was able to kind of beat everyone and nobody wanted to fight him anymore. So he was going to pick up and leave, but I guess they had sparked a good friendship and this guy Gastão Gracie really didn't want him to go. So he convinced Maeda to stay and train his son. And I guess his son was like a small, skinny guy, getting into a lot of trouble, and Gastão wanted his son to be able to learn an art, get some discipline. But the thing was, obviously, Maeda's teacher really, you know, warned him never to train foreigners in the full art. But for whatever reason, you know, Maeda decided, look, I'm going to teach this one kid and this one kid only, you know, the secrets, and I'll train him up and I'll get him good. So this kid was a fellow by the name of Carlos Gracie. And he would go and, you know, train with Maeda in the training hall, and he would go after schools, and sometimes he would bring his brothers with him. I guess he had a few brothers. And one of his brothers, I believe it was the youngest and smallest kind of runt, and he had, like, asthma and was just kind of a, you know, I guess a, you could call him a nerd or a bookworm type of guy. But for whatever reason, this fella by the name of Elio Gracie was just kind of a natural. He would look at the techniques and watch them train and just kind of soak it up. And for whatever reason being, he was just kind of a natural at jiu-jitsu. I've seen that where guys come in, they've had no formal training in jiu-jitsu, but, you know, look, they're just naturals, and that's the way it seems to go. So eventually, Elio and Carlos would go on to take what Maeda told them and taught them about, you know, not only the jiu-jitsu techniques, but also the judo, and also what Maeda had learned while in America about, you know, Greco-Roman wrestling and some boxing and stuff. And they would kind of take that and turn it into Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And ultimately, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, with some, you know, strong marketing and just smart thinking, has turned into what it is today. As far as, you know, the military uses it, law enforcement's huge on it, mixed martial arts is huge, and it seems like this is kind of the new trend, the new thing as far as martial arts go, at least in the States. It's kind of what Taekwondo used to be. All the cool kids are doing it. So anyways, that's kind of a brief history as far as the difference between Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and pure Japanese Jiu-Jitsu, kind of where they both came from. I thought it was kind of an interesting study, or, you know, interesting to learn about, especially, you know, having been doing BJJ for the past year and a half or so. Two YouTube videos I'd really like to credit for this that I used in my research is A Brief History of the Evolution of Jiu-Jitsu by Karate Shotokan. And the other video was The Toughest Man Who Ever Lived, Brazilian Judo, by a guy named TriStar Jim. And I thank you both, gentlemen. Your videos were really great. You really should go and look up these guys. They, you know, it seems like they've got some really great information and good topics. So with that in mind, you know, quick plug here. You can follow me on Instagram, Gutter Fighting Secrets. You can also be looking for the new DVD coming out, Travel Safety for Americans Abroad, packed full of some really badass shit. Also, Gutter Fighting Secrets, the original DVD. Both of those are available at gutterfightingsecrets.com. So I appreciate your time. Hopefully you got something from watching this video. I thought it was an interesting topic. I know anybody who rolls probably will also kind of feel like this is an interesting topic. You can certainly learn more about it by watching videos like the two gentlemen that I previously mentioned, and I'm sure there's a lot more other good information out there. If you find anything that you think may need to be corrected about my information or any, you know, historical details I left out that you think is important, please just write them in the comments. You know, I'll try to get back to you if I need to. Please remember that you are your first and last line of defense.